CFO Studio is sponsored by Real Estate Strategies Corporation, advisors to CFOs, management, and boards of directors in the acquisition and disposition of leased and owned real estate. Visit us online at realstrat.com.
This is CFO Studio, and I'm your host, Andrew Zezas. I'm joined today by Mr. Jay Stile, Senior Vice President and Chief Financial Officer of Mathematica. Mr. Stile has been with Mathematica for 27 years. He began his career in government accounting at the Pennsylvania Department of Labor and Industry, and then at the U.S. Department of Labor. During Mr. Stile's tenure, Mathematica has grown from under $8 million in revenue to approximately $200 million in revenue, and employment has grown from 75 to 940 people around the country. Mathematica is in the business of evaluating public policy programs for federal and state governments, as well as private foundations. Clients of Mathematica include the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation and the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, among others. Today, Mr. Stile is here to talk to us about ESOPs and the role of the CFO. Jay, it's so nice to have you here on CFO Studio. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me. Thank you.
So we're here today to talk about ESOPs, not the fable, but the corporate structure and the role of the CFO. But before I ask you to talk about that, give us some background on Mathematica. Tell me about the company and what it does.
Mathematica began its work about 45 years ago. We do evaluations of public policy programs, mostly for the federal government, but also state governments and private foundations. Hmm. So we do research looking at the impacts of programs for Department of Education and education programs or healthcare reform programs, which is a growing area right now. Mm-hmm. Also nutrition programs, employment and training, welfare reform, and more recently we're looking at issues like teacher effectiveness and providing technical assistance to some of our clients also.
So in evaluating programs, you're measuring effectiveness?
Yes, that's right.
And your programs are short-term, long-term in nature?
They can be either. A short-term contract for us would be about a year long. Oh. And maybe $100,000 or $200,000 in the contract value. We have a few contracts that go on for five or more years, and they can range upwards of $50 million for a very large contract.
Wow, that's impressive. So how is Mathematica different from other companies?
I think in a few ways, but the key difference as I see it is its mission. Mathematica is in the business to improve the public well-being by providing the highest quality objective research to our clients. And all of our work is nonpartisan. It has to stand up to peer review by other researchers, and it is strictly to report on what the data about that program show.
Mm. So it's very high-level research.
It is.
Now, the company structure is unusual as well. I believe the company is an ESOP.
That's correct. We have been employee-owned for a long period of time, but beginning in 2005, we changed our ownership form and became owned by our employees through our ESOP. And an ESOP is a retirement plan, a retirement trust, regulated by ERISA. And all of our 900 and some employees are owners of the company through that form of ownership.
900 some odd employees. Okay, so employee stock ownership plan. How do they work? Give me a little more detail. And I remember that you also said something about the origin or the most common uses of ESOPs.
Yeah, I think many ESOPs, as I've observed them, began in the Midwest with family-owned companies. I'm saying the Midwest because of having sort of old-line manufacturing firms there, and the original owner may have done a nice job in building the company. Now he or she is getting ready to retire and pass on ownership to the company to someone else, and the ESOP structure enables the owner to sell the company to the employees of the company. There are certain tax advantages that the seller can take advantage by doing that, and it provides an ability for then the employees of that company to continue to operate the company the way the owner had and carry it forward under their ownership.
So very common with family and entrepreneurially run companies. Tell me a little bit about Mathematica's ESOP, because if my memory serves me correctly, it's got some unique components to it.
That's correct. And we were never a family-owned company, but we, as I said, were employee-owned through other structures, actually through ownership through our profit-sharing plan, all the way back through its origins. When I joined the company in 1985, we were originally owned by the Martin Marietta Corporation for a brief period of time became employee-owned when we did a management buyout then. But in 2005, we changed that structure to an ESOP form of ownership. So at that point in time, all of the employees became owners through the ESOP plan and in a second transaction to acquire all of the shares that were held outside of that ESOP trust at the time. In 2007, we did a second transaction, after which we converted from a C corporation form of corporation to an S corporation.
Oh.
And that enabled the company to obtain certain tax benefits. As you know, C corporation is taxed at the corporate level. Under an S corporation, the taxes flow to the shareholders of the company. Since our ESOP owns 100% of the shares of Mathematica, and the ESOP is a tax-deferred retirement trust, there is no federal income taxes that are paid by Mathematica or by the ESOP trust. And the cash flow that's generated by that tax savings has enabled the company to continue to grow, to invest in itself, and to build value on behalf of the shareholders. Mm. Now, just to get to the end of that story, the shareholders do eventually pay taxes when they take their distributions from retirement trusts, just as they would from other qualified retirement plans.
We all pay taxes, don't we?
Correct. We will.
So, Jay, tell me, what special challenges exist in running the business as you do today?
Well, we have about 300 concurrent projects. So from
300?
Yes.
Wow.
From a management standpoint, we need to make sure that we're performing on all 300 of those projects. We have a substantial review process and accounting process that's all geared toward project accounting. We provide very detailed financial information on the performance of the project to the project directors, and we review projects on a monthly basis with the project director to make sure that the project is on time, it's on budget, the client relationships are good, and we're delivering all the work that's within the scope of work on that contract.
Wow, so this is really a people business. I mean, this is a personal service delivery vehicle.
Exactly. The thing that really drives our business is that we sell our time. So the staff that are engaged on our projects need to be deployed efficiently across all of our contracts in order for us to be profitable and successful.
So that's how you manage the drivers and profitability, staying close to each of the employees.
That's correct, yes.
Tell me about the issues that are of significance to Mathematica that are, you know, years to come. What are you guys thinking about the future?
Well, we have a fairly immediate issue right now because of the federal deficit concerns, and we know that there are plans in place to attempt to reach some budget resolution going forward that might enable the federal government to find a way to cut into that deficit. Since we're reliant upon federal spending in order to get our contracts, we have some concerns about what the impacts of deficit reduction solutions might be on us. Now, we do feel, because we're very able to inform the government through evidence on the projects we've studied about what projects work and what projects don't work, that our work might still be in demand, even in light of reductions in federal spending, to be able to provide that evidence to decision makers who are looking to know what projects to cut and which ones to fund. But that's certainly one of the concerns we have going forward. The other thing I would mention is the importance of maintaining confidentiality and privacy over all the data that we gather in the performance of our work. And we have an opportunity to get what's called personally identifiable information, or in the case of HIPAA, private health information in the conduct of our analysis. And there are increasingly complex regulations that govern the how that data is handled and how the privacy of individuals are protected, we need to make sure we're always out in front of those regulations and ensuring that we're in compliance with those.
So some very sensitive matters,
correct,
to say the least.
Yes.
Jay, let me ask you about your role as CFO, and I actually want to jump back to the issue of an ESOP. How's the job of a CFO affected, in Mathematica's case, by the company being an ESOP?
Well, you come in the door with all the other owners of the company every day. So since you're working in that type of culture with your employees, we tend to be very open book. We like to share as much information about the performance of the company, including the financial information, and communicate with our employees on a regular basis to let them know how their company is performing as a result of the work that they're doing.
Hmm. Well, Jay, we're almost out of time. I have time for one more question, actually, and staying in that vein about the role of the CFO, how's your job changed over the years? 27 years with the company is a long time, and I'm
yes,
sure with technology and everything else, there's been a lot of evolution.
That's correct. I think with all the growth that causes strains in any organization, we've strived to maintain the consistency of our special culture that we have at Mathematica, both from the time when we've been a much smaller company up through now. And I think the two other areas I would mention are probably more common to lots of CFOs, in that we're using technology more and more to communicate information. We work on data analytics and dashboards in order to try to get the information that our managers need out in front of them in as real time as possible to help them do their jobs.
So as CFO, your job has become much more complex.
It has, and one last item I would add to that is we become more risk managers. Also, over time, it's not all about number crunching anymore, but it's always looking forward to see what the threats to your business are and taking appropriate steps to mitigate them.
Well, Jay, Mathematica certainly sounds like an incredibly dynamic company. I mean, growth from 8 to 200 million and 75 right, to 940 employees. 27 years at the company says an awful lot about you as a finance executive. I truly appreciate the comments you shared with us today. I hope you'll permit us to invite you back again sometime.
Okay. Thank you. I appreciate it.
It's been great to have you here.
Thank you.
This is Andrew Zezas, your host at CFO Studio with Jay Style of Mathematica, saying thank you very much for watching. We'll see you again.
The CFO's Guide to Understanding Corporate Real Estate Transactions is packed with almost 200 pages of insightful real estate acquisition and disposition strategies. Request your free copy online at cfostudio.com. CFO Studio is sponsored by Real Estate Strategies Corporation, advisors to CFOs, management, and boards of directors in the acquisition and disposition of leased and owned real estate. Visit us online at realstrat.com.